Today we will solve JAM 2020 question paper. The first question is, the Mesozoic era approximately ranges from, and the answer is, it ranges from 250 to 65 million years. As you can see in the figure, Paleozoic era extends from 541 million years to 252 million years. And for Mesozoic, it is 252 to 66 million years. Okay. After 66 million years comes Cenozoic era, which continues till the present. Okay. Next question. A trench is found at A. Now see, whenever you will find a trench, you will find a trench in a convergent plate boundary only. Be it ocean-ocean convergence or be it ocean-continent convergence. So trench is a characteristic feature of convergent plate boundary. Okay. As you can see from the figure, in a convergent plate boundary, when two plates collide, one plate which is denser goes down into the mantle, and as a result a depression is formed on the surface, and this depression is called as trench. Okay. Next question. The strike of a bed dipping 30 degree towards north, 45 degree west is. So we have a bed which dipping 30 degree towards north, 45 degree west. Okay. So if you put the bed in the stereo net, then the deep direction of the bed is marked by line A, that is north 45 degree west. And as you know, a bed has the deep direction perpendicular to its strike. Okay. So the strike of the bed must be perpendicular to the deep. And exactly that's the reason why the answer should be 045225. See, these are the numbers which are called the whole circle bearing. Okay. And these values are measured only from the north pole direction. Okay. Next question. A randomly oriented ore bearing bendlets in a mass of rock are known as. So here we have a rock which contains very small veins in it, and in the veins there is mineralization. Okay. Then such a structure is known as. So the answer should be, such a structure is known as stock works. Okay. These are formed when the hydrothermal solutions percolate through the weak zones of the rock and they mineralize there. Let's look at the other options. Anaclan veins are short, parallel, and planar mineral field lanes within a body of rock. They are parallel, and as soon as they form, they rotate in the shear zone. Okay. And this causes the vein to take on a sigmoidal shape. And later, these veins are filled up with minerals like quartz, calcite, etc. Next, we have seated veins. They are a set of closely spaced, distinct parallel fractures or veins filled with mineralization. Okay. So if you compare Anaclan veins with seated veins, then they both are parallel. Okay. So in both the cases, the veins are parallel to each other. In Anaclan gas veins, veins are small and they are sigmoidal in shape. But in case of seat veins, they are generally large veins and they are distinct and closely spaced. Okay. The next question is, the diagnostic amphibole in a blue-cyst facies metabasalt is, and the answer should be glaucophane, because glaucophane is a characteristic mineral of blue-cyst facies, and due to its blue color, the facies is named as blue-cyst facies. Okay. Next question. Atoll is a geomorphic feature produced by, and the answer should be, it is formed by coral reef accumulation. In the figure you can see there are three types of coral reef, and they are fringing reef, barrier reef, and atoll. So when there is a volcanic eruption in the ocean, when the erupted magma cools down, it forms an island or a small landform at that point. And if given suitable conditions, corals begin to accumulate all around it. And that's the first state of formation of coral reef, and that is called fringing reef. Gradually, and more corals begin to accumulate at that point, then it forms a barrier reef. Okay. And in the last step, when the landmass completely subsides into the ocean, then the geomorphic feature formed by coral reefs is called atoll. Okay. So atolls are formed by coral reef accumulation. Okay. Next question. Approximately 71% of the planetary mass in the solar system is concentrated in. The answer is, it is concentrated at the vast planet called Jupiter. Due to its huge mass and volume, it constitutes 71% of the total planetary mass of the solar system. Okay. Now in the question you have to mark it that 71% of the planetary mass is asked. But if the question would have asked about the total solar system, Then the maximum mass and volume of the solar system is contributed by the sun itself. Okay. Next question. Which of the following oil field is not located in the western part of India? And you can see Bombay High, Ankleshwar, and Gandhar. All of these oil fields are in the western India, and the only oil field that is Moran is in Assam, which is not located in the western part of India. Okay. Next question. The most abundant element in the Earth's continental crust is. Now, in this figure, you can see the most abundant element on the Earth crust by weight percentage, and clearly oxygen wins the race. Next comes silicon, next aluminium, next iron, calcium, etc. So our answer will be oxygen. The next question is, mammalian fossils are commonly found in. And to answer this question, you must consider when mammalians flourish on the Earth's surface. Now see, although mammals are evolved in around Mesozoic era, but they flourished completely on the Earth's surface in Cenozoic era only. Okay, so here the answer should be Trivalic group, because this is the group that whose age is only Cenozoic, right? Now see, Hemanta group is of extrapeninsular region and is of Precambrian era. Jabalpur is of Lower Purana, which is of Proterozoic. Shivalik is of Neogene age, Cenozoic, and Utator group is of Cretaceous age, which is of Mesozoic era. Okay. Next question: hardness of groundwater is determined by, and the answer is they are determined by the concentration of calcium and magnesium present in that groundwater. Next question: which one of the following defines an hexagonal dipyramid? And the answer should be it is a mirror plane that is perpendicular to the vertical six-fold axis of symmetry. Here in the figure, you can see an hexagonal bipyramid at the left, and you can see that there is a six-fold axis of symmetry, and there is a mirror plane at the center that divides, that is perpendicular to the six-fold axis. Okay. Next question: match the tuning in group 1 with their corresponding mineral in group 2. So, crosshatch tuning is shown by microcline, calcite tuning by sanidine, polysynthetic tuning is the characteristic feature of plagioclase, and Brazil tuning is shown by quartz. So our answer will be option B. Okay. Next question: evidence of late Paleozoic glaciation recorded in. Now this was recorded in Talcher Formation, which is a succession of Gondwana supergroup. Okay, which ranges from Upper Carboniferous to Lower Cretaceous. And Talcher Formation, which is the oldest formation of Gondwana supergroup. And in this group, evidence of late Paleozoic glaciations are found. Okay. Next question: match the landform in group 1 with the corresponding geological process in group 2. Now, cinder cone is a volcanic feature. Okay. Oxbow Lake is obviously a fluvial feature. Dras is a aeolian feature. And Drumlin is a glacial feature. Okay. So our answer should be option A. Next question: identify the fault in the given figure, where T naught and T alpha represent the axial plane thickness at the hinge and the limb respectively. And as you can see from the question, the axial plane thickness at the hinge and the limb are the same, that is at 5 cm. Okay. So the fold here should be similar fold, right? That is class 2 fold. Next question is, identify the type of fault in the given figure. And from the lenition on the fault plane, you can see that one block is moving down comparison to other block, so this is a normal fault. Okay. Next question: in a clastic sediments, the correct order of decreasing grain size is. And the correct order should be cobble greater than granule, and the correct order should be cobble greater than granule, greater than silt, and greater than clay. Okay. As you can see from the figure, there are mainly three grain types. One is gravel, that is comparatively coarse grained. Second one is sand, which is of medium grain, and mud, which is of fine grain. Okay. And they have their subdivisions respectively. Okay. Next question: match the primary secondary structures in group 1 with their corresponding process of formation in group 2. So asymmetrical ripples transport bed load in the sediments. Okay. In decent pillar structure, we get water escape. Right. In fruit cast, we get scoring by turbulent eddy, and OB beddings are related with deposition from alternate traction and suspension load. Okay. So our answer will be option B. Okay. Next question: The correct pair of metal and their ore mineral is. So, sphalerite is a sulfide of zinc, that is ZnS. Cassiterite is tin oxide. So, that is the correct match. That is, cassiterite is a ore of tin. Okay. Now, see, pyrolusite is MnO2, which is not a ore of zinc. It is a ore of manganese, right? And bornite, which formula is Cu5FeS4. And it is a copper and iron sulfide. And it is not a lead sulfide. So, the answer should be option 2. Cassiterite is a ore of tin. Okay. Next question. Match the mineral or metal deposit in group 1 with the corresponding Indian occurrence in group 2. So, we get diamond in Vajrakarur. That is a very famous diamond ore deposit. And Malanskanj is very famous for its copper deposit. Okay. Now, we are left with iron and fluorite. So, we get fluorite in Ambadongar and we are left with only one option for iron and that is Dali Rajhara. So, our answer will be option D. Okay. Next question. The mineral sequence arranged in order of increasing degree of sharing SiO4 tetrahedra is. So, we will have olivine at the first because it is of nesosilicate and in nesosilicate there is no sharing of SiO4 tetrahedra. Okay. Next, we have enstatite, which is a pyroxene, which comes under single chain ionosilicate and here two of the four oxygen of the SiO4 tetrahedra are shared. Okay. Next we should have tremolite, which is a amphibole, which comes under double chain ionosilicate structure. Okay. And in double chain ionosilicate, two chains are linked together in such a way that each tetrahedral group shares three of its oxygen. And last we should have quartz, which is a tectosilicate, which shares all the four oxygen atoms of the SiO4 tetrahedra with their surrounding atoms. Okay. Next question. The metamorphic phases series that explains bosonic subduction zone metamorphism is. Now, because it is a subduction zone metamorphism, then it is performed under high pressure condition. So, the correct answer should be prehnite pumpelite, then brucite, and then eclogite. If it would have been any kind of contact metamorphism, then the answer should be option C, that is albite epidote, then hornblende hornpels, then pyroxene hornpels, and finally cyanidinate hornpels. And that's a high temperature metamorphic series. Okay. But here you were asked about subduction zone metamorphism. That's why our answer should be option A. Right. Next question. The correct combination of textural features of magmatic rock with corresponding petrological process is. And the first option is exsolution laminae corresponds to subsolidus cooling. So in exsolution laminae, two liquids get separated. And that process occurs through subsolidus cooling. So, the option 1 is the correct answer. But let's look at the other options as well. Reaction rim in eutectic crystallization. No, this cannot be the answer because in eutectic crystallization, there is no reaction involved. So, there is no question of the formation of any reaction rim there. Next, we have graphic intergrowth in quenching of ultramafic lava, which is also not possible because quenching means the sudden cooling of magma. And by sudden cooling, we get glassy texture. But there is no question of any graphic intergrowth there. Okay. And next we have spinifex structure due to peritectic crystallization. This is also not possible because in spinifex structure, we get long acicular fenocrysts of olivine or pyroxene, which gives the rock a bladed appearance, especially on a weathered surface. Okay. And this condition is not possible in peritectic crystallization. Next question. A volcanic rock consisting of alkali feldspar 70%, rhodic plagioclase 10% and nepheline 20% is named as. Now let's look at the QAPF diagram. And as you can clearly see from the figure, if a rock contains alkali feldspar 70% and rhodic plagioclase 10%, then the rock automatically comes under phonolite and phonolite 10% confirms the same, right? Next question. Match the name of granitoid in group 1 with the corresponding craton in group 2. So, close plate granite is of Dharwar supergroup, which separates eastern and western Dharwar craton. Berak granite is a part of Aravali craton. Dongargarh granitoid is a part of Bastar craton. And Moyurbhanj granitoid is a part of Singhbhum craton. Okay. So, our answer will be option B. And as you can clearly see from the figure, Conrad discontinuity is between upper and lower crust. Mohorovic discontinuity is between crust and upper mantle. Gutenberg discontinuity is between lower mantle and outer core. And finally, Lehmann discontinuity is between outer core and inner core. Next question. Choose the correct statement. First option. Porosity of weathered granite is less than that of a crystalline granite. Now, this is wrong because weathering erodes away some part of the rock, but it doesn't loosen up the rock and hence it doesn't increase the pore spaces in between it. So, weathering has no effect on porosity of granite. Okay. Next option, coarse sands have high porosity and have high permeability. This option is correct because sand particles have high porosity and high permeability as well. Next option, clay have high porosity and high permeability, which is wrong because clay have high porosity but they have low permeability. Okay. And the last option, groundwater table doesn't fluctuate with water recharge. This is wrong because groundwater table does fluctuate with water recharge, right? Okay, next question. In the given profile section, P, Q, R, S, and T are the sedimentary rocks. Now identify the type of unconformity in the sedimentary sequence. So as you can clearly see, P, Q, R are parallel to each other, but after that, S and T, their orientation changes, and this conformity hence is a angular unconformity. Okay. Where the lower beds are parallel to each other, but the beds at the top of it making some angle with the underlying rocks. Okay. Next question, which of the following pairs is not correctly matched? And as you can see, there is everything is correctly matched except Glypha lamellibranchia. But here it is written it is a gastropoda, which is wrong. Okay. And in the question, it is marked, mark out the incorrectly matched pair. So the answer should be option D. Okay. Next question, which of the following statement is in relation to their solar system is correct? Now, the most abundant elements are hydrogen and helium in the solar system. That is correct. The most abundance of elements with atomic number 1 to 50. So, an overall decreasing trend. That is also correct. Okay. Next option, the abundance of heavier elements, that is the element which is having atomic number greater than 50, are mostly higher than that of the lighter elements. This is wrong and actually this is the reverse. That is, lighter elements have more abundance than the heavier elements. Okay. Next option, elements having odd atomic number are more abundant than their neighbors. This is also wrong because elements having odd atomic number are less abundant than their intermediate neighbors. Okay. Next question, find out the correct statement. Orthogenic minerals form during the digestion of sandstone. This is correct. Heavy minerals in sandstone are good indicator of provenance. That is also correct because heavy minerals are used to indicate the provenance in the sandstone, right? Next option, an arkose is mineralogically more mature than a quartz arenite. Now this is wrong because mineralogically, if a rock has more quartz, then we call it more mature. And in quartz arenite, there is more quartz than arkose because in arkose, feldspar is dominant. Okay. So, quartz arenite is more mineralogically mature than arkose. Okay. Next option, matrix in sandstone may form by post-depositional infiltration or orthogenic filling. Now, this is also correct because in the formation of matrix, after the femur grains are being deposited, then after that matrix are infiltrated into the rock. Okay. So the correct answer is A, C and D. Next question, which of the following statements are correctly matched? Dendritic drainage pattern is uniform substrate and gentle slope. That is correct. Trellis drainage pattern is parallel valleys and ridges. That is also correct. Next option, radial drainage pattern is uniform flat topography. Now this is wrong because in radial drainage pattern, the streams diverge or radiate outward from a high central area. So, it is not a uniform flat topography and hence this option is not correct, right? Then we have rectangular drainage pattern which forms in joint and faults. That is also correct. So, our answer will be option A, B and D. Next question, a northerly dipping fault FF has displaced bed P, Q and R. The thickness of the bed across the fault is same. Now identify the fault type. You can clearly see that hanging walls is moving up comparison to the foot wall. So this is a reverse fault. Okay. Now looking at the movement of the fault, this fault can also be a transform fault. But we have to determine whether it is dextral or it is sinistral fault. Now see, north block is the block that is moving. Okay. Now if you face yourself to the fault, in the way that it is shown in figure 2 on the right side, then you can see that the left block is moving towards you. So you can say that it is a sinistral fault. Now if the right block would have come towards you, that is the south block, if it would have moved towards you, then we can call it a dextral fault. But here only the north block is moving, right? And it is in the left side and it is moving towards us, towards the viewer. Okay.
Okay. Next question.
A bedding plane pictorially represented at X will be plotted in stereo net as. And if you see in the figure, then you can note that X is a vertical bed. So it has a dip of 90 degree and it can be pictorially represented as line 3. Okay. Because line 3 represents a bed which has a dip of 90 degree.
The next question is, choose the correct statement. And the first option is, stratiform chromite deposits are formed by the weathering of ultramafic rocks. Now it is true that the stratiform chromite deposits are formed from ultramafic rocks, but the process of formation is igneous process and they are not formed by weathering process. Okay. So option 1 is not correct. Second option is, skarn deposits mostly form in calcareous host rocks in contact with felsic intrusive. Now this option is a correct option. Okay. Next option, nickeliferous laterite is a type of placer deposit. Now this is not correct because nickeliferous laterites are formed by the weathering of olivine rich ultramafic rocks and they are not a type of placer deposit. Okay. And the last option is, gold bearing veins deposit can form from hydrothermal solutions. Because we get gold as a vein deposit from hydrothermal solutions.
So if the mineral remains dark at all stages of the rotation of the microscope, then the mineral might be isotropic. So option 1 is correct. Next option, the mineral is biaxial with an optic orientation corresponding to the principal section of the indicatrix. Now this cannot be the answer because if the optic axis orientation corresponds to the principal section of the indicatrix, then also some light should pass through the microscope and it should not be completely dark, right? Okay, let's look at the
third option.
The mineral is biaxial with an optic orientation containing Y vibration. Now that could be the answer because in crossed polar condition, both the polarizers and analyzer are perpendicular to each other. So the light passing through the Y vibration direction gets blocked, right? So that we can get dark all over the microscope. And next option, the mineral is uniaxial with an orientation perpendicular to the optic axis. Now we all know that if a mineral is oriented in such a way that the light passes through the optic axis of the mineral, then the mineral behaves isotropically. So among them, only the option B is not correct and so the answer is option B. Next question, a schematic deformation D and metamorphism M time map of a metamorphic belt is shown below. The belt recorded two phases of deformation D1 and D2 and attained sisterosities S1 and S2 and at the same time there is metamorphism M1 and M2. The metamorphic mineral stable during these events are shown by solid lines. Now on the basis of this information, which of the following statement is or are correct? Now in option 1 we are given M1 and M2 events refer to regional and contour metamorphism respectively. Now see, in regional metamorphism we have a greater deformation intensity and a greater sisterosity as well, which is seen in figure of D1 and M1, and clearly there is no sisterosity developed in contact metamorphism. So in M2 there is no sisterosity there. So option 1 is correct. Now the next option is, the S1 sisterosity developed as a crenulation cleavage. Now this is not correct because
S1 refers to the first stage of sisterosity and in the first stage itself any cleavage, lineation, foliation, all these are not formed. Okay. So option B is not correct.
If it would have given that S2 instead of S1 in the option, then that refers to the second stage of sisterosity and there is a chance that crenulation cleavage might be formed at there. Okay, next option, garnet groove seen tectonic with D1. Now look at the stability zone of garnet. It is stable only when deformation intensity of D1 is maximum, right? And as the deformation intensity goes down, garnet vanishes, that is, it is no more stable in that particular region. So it is correctly said that garnet groove seen tectonic with D1. Now the word seen tectonic here means garnet grew simultaneously with the deformation D1. Okay. So option C is correct. And the last option is andalusite grew during the warming phase of DT. Now this answer is not correct because andalusite is not formed due to any kind of deformation. It is formed due to the schistosity. So we have option A and option C as the correct answer, right? Next question. Choose the correct statement. Gravity dam is a rigid structure, straight or slightly curved in places. This is correct. Arc dams are commonly built on very strong foundations. Now this is not correct because the foundation of the arc dams are not so strong. Okay, next option. Buttress dam chiefly consists of reinforced concrete slab that slopes upstream. Here in the figure you can see that the concrete slab of the buttress dam are upslopes upstream. Okay. Arch dams have a concrete wall curved with convex face pointed towards the upstream. And as you can see from the figure, there is no curvature in the arch dam. So the correct answer is option A and option C. Next question. Choose the correct pairs. The first option is Proterozoic, the origin of flowering plants. Now this is wrong because the origin of flowering plants occurred nearly in Cretaceous age, which is of late Mesozoic era. Okay, next option. Paleozoic is the origin of amphibians. This is correct. Next option. Mesozoic is the acme of trilobites. Now the term acme means the point at which something is at its best or it is highly developed. And trilobites are highly developed in Paleozoic era. So this is not the correct answer. And last, Cenozoic is the dominance of mammals. So the current era is known as Cenozoic era. And in this era, mammals are dominating in the world. So this is the correct answer. So the correct answers of the questions is option B and option D. And with that, we have completed all our MSQ and MCQ questions. And we are only left with our numerical questions. So the first question of the numerical section is the weight percentage of copper in chalcopyrite is, and the atomic weight of copper, iron and sulfur are given. Now see, chalcopyrite has a formula CuFeS2. So weight percentage of copper is the atomic weight of copper divided by the total atomic weight of the chalcopyrite whole into 100. And if you calculate, the value comes out to be 34.62%. Okay. Next question. The general formula of an amphibole mineral is A0-1, B2-5, T8-O22 and OH-12, where A, B, C and T are cationic sites with different coordination number as stated below. A equal to 12, B equal to 6-8, C equal to 6 and T equal to 4. Now the question is, the amount of octahedral aluminium in an amphibole of composition sodium 0.6, calcium 2, magnesium 3.8, aluminium 3 and silicon 6.2, O22, OH2 is. Now look at the general formula of the amphibole. There you will see T8. That means there must be 8 tetrahedral atoms in a general amphibole. But in the given composition, silicon has already occupied 6.2. And as we all know, aluminium can be present in tetrahedral as well as in the octahedral sides. So the aluminium in the tetrahedral side is 8 minus 6.2, that is 1.8. And remaining all aluminium goes into the octahedral side, that is 3 minus 1.8, that is 1.2. Okay. Next question. In the block diagram, the net slip equal to 100 meter is resolved into strike slip and deep slip component. Now the value of S in meters correct to 2 decimal places is. Now if you closely look at the diagram, then you can see there is a right angle triangle there and the hypotenuse of the right angle triangle measures 100 meter, which is the net slip condition. And there are two other sides which represent deep slip and strike slip component. Now see, deep slip is the component that is parallel to the deep direction of the fault plane. And similarly, strike slip component is parallel to the strike of the fault plane. And in the solution, we have redrawn this triangle so that it would be easier for you to understand. Now, if you put simple trigonometric formulas into the right angle triangle, then you can get that cos 30 equal to base by hypotenuse, that is S by 100. And from there, you can calculate the value of S to be 86.60. Next question. the true thickness of bed B in the given diagram is. Now similarly, for our convenience, we will redraw the diagram, and hence if you put simple trigonometric formulas, then you can get sin 30 equal to P by H, that is T by 20 here, and from there the value of T is calculated as 10 meters. Next question, if 3 to 6 is the Miller index of a crystal face, then the value of X in the corresponding width parameter of the same face XA is to YB is to ZC is. Now see, we have given the Miller indices as 3, 2 and 6. So the first step that we have to take is to take the reciprocal of all the Miller indices. And so they are 1 by 3, 1 by 2 and 1 by 6 respectively. Now because they are all in fractions, so our next step will be to normalize all the fractions. And to normalize, we take the LCM of all the denominators here. The LCM of 3, 2 and 6 is 6. And we multiply that value, which is 6 here, into all the fractions. And hence, we get the result as 2, 3 and 1. But in the question, we are asked about the value of x. So, the value of x is 2 here. Okay. Next question. The value of h in the Miller-Bravais indices bar for 1 h naught is dash. So, for a hexagonal system, all the Miller indices must add up to 1. Now, bar 4 means minus 4. And if you add up all those things, then you will get the value of h equal to 3. Okay. Next question. In an ocean basin, a 4 million year old oceanic crust lies 40 km away from the ridge axis. Then the average velocity in centimeter per year of the oceanic lithosphere is. Now mark one thing, that we are asked the average velocity in centimeter per year. So first we have to convert the total distance into centimeter. Okay. 1 km equal to 10 to the power 3 meters. So 40 km equal to 40 into 10 to the power 3 meters. And similarly, if you calculate, 1 meter equal to 100 centimeter. So we will get 4 into 10 to the power 6 centimeter. Okay. Now the total time we are given is 4 million years. That is 4 into 10 to the power 6 years. Okay. So the average velocity equal to total distance divided by total time. And if you calculate the value, it comes out to be 1 centimeter per year. Right. Okay, next question. An aquifer has a cross-sectional area of 1000 meter square and a hydraulic gradient of 0.01. Now, if the water is flowing from aquifer at a rate of 10 meter cube per second, then the hydraulic conductivity in meter per second of the aquifer is dash. So, we know the Darcy law equal to Q equal to Ki into A, where Q is the discharge, K is the hydraulic conductivity, I is the hydraulic gradient and A is the area. And from that equation, if you calculate the value of K, then it comes out to be 1 meter per second. Okay. Next question. According to the mineralogical phase rule, the number of minerals that can coexist at equilibrium in a 8 component chemical system with 2 degree of freedom is. So we are given the number of component equal to 8 and the degree of freedom equal to 2. And we are asked the number of phases that can coexist. Okay. So we apply the mineralogical phase rule, that is P plus F equal to C plus 2. And if you put the values of P, F and C, then you will get the value of P comes out to be 8. Okay. Next question. The grain density and the bulk density of a sandstone sample are 2.7 gram per cc and 2.3 gram per cc respectively. The total porosity in percentage of the sample is. Now see, we have a formula, that is porosity equal to 1 minus rho b by rho s, where rho b is the bulk density and rho s is the solid density. Now if you put the values of bulk density and solid density in the formula, then you can find the porosity as 14.81%. Okay. Next question. In an undeformed and normal stratigraphic succession, a dolerite dike was impressed before deposition of sandstone B. And the difference between the maximum edges of the deposition of sandstone A and sandstone B is dash. Now look at sandstone B. It is present over volcanic ash bed which has an age of 132 million years. So the maximum age of sandstone B is 132 million years, right? Similarly, if you see, sandstone B is deposited just after the intrusion of the dolerite dike. So the maximum age of sandstone A can be 75 million years, right? Now the difference between them is 132 minus 75, that is 57 million years. Okay. Next question. A coal seam occurs in a stratigraphic sequence as shown in the figure. If a vertical borehole is drilled at location B, the coal seam will be intersected at a depth of dash in meters. Now see, if we drill a vertical hole at location B, which has a contour value of 500, so after dipping vertically, the next contour value that touches the coal seam is 400. So the depth at which the coal seam will be intersected is 100 meters only. Next question. A set of sedimentary rocks A, B and C are affected by a fault FF. The amount of vertical throw in meters along the fault is dash. Now look at the margin of bed B and bed C. In the footwall side, this margin is at a contour value of 500, right? And in the hanging wall side, the same margin between bed B and bed C is found at 400 contour interval. So the amount of vertical throw along the fault is 500 minus 400, that is 100 meters. Okay. Next question. The retardation of a uniaxial negative mineral of thickness 0.03 mm is 5160 nanometer in its principal section of indicatrix. If the refractive index corresponds to the E ray is 1.486, then the value of refractive index of O ray is. Now we know the formula retardation equal to thickness whole into birefringence, and in the question we have given the thickness of the principal section. So here we have to calculate only the birefringence. So the birefringence is the difference in the refractive index of E ray and O ray. We are already given the refractive index of E ray is 1.486. So if you put all this information in the formula, then you can calculate the value of refractive index of O ray, that is N2 here is 1.658. Next question. A spherical ore body of diameter 40 meter has 7% metal content and density of 3300 gram per meter cube. Now the reserve of the ore body in tons is. So we have the formula as reserve equal to average grade into tonnage. And in the question we are given, the average grade is 7%. So we have to calculate the tonnage of the reserve. Now the formula of tonnage equal to density into volume. Now because it is a spherical ore body, so its volume equal to 4 by 3 pi and r cube. Note that we have given the diameter equal to 40 meter, so the radius will be 40 by 2, that is 20 meters. So we can calculate the tonnage as density into volume. The density is given 3300 kg per meter cube, and we have to multiply the volume, that is 4 by 3 pi r cube, and then we have to calculate the reserve by multiplying the average grade, that is 7%, into the total tonnage. Now note here that the total reserve is asked in tons, and 1 ton equal to 10 to the power 3 kgs. So we have to change the total kgs into tons, okay? And our final answer comes out to be 7736.960 tons. Next question. From the data shown in the table, the weighted mean size in micrometer of the sediment population is. Now in the question we are given a grain size and their dry sediment weight, and we are asked the weighted mean size of the sediment population. And for the weighted mean size, we have to multiply each grain size with their dry sediment weight and add them up all, and we have to divide the total value by the total dry sediment weight. And if you calculate, the total value comes out to be 32.33 micrometer. Next question. Consider the schematic isobaric temperature concentration phase diagram in the binary fosterite phyllite chemical system. If there is equilibrium crystallization of the melt, then the weight percentage of the olivine crystallized from a melt of composition A at temperature T2 is. Now, if you constantly decrease the temperature from T1 to T2, then at temperature T2, we have two compositions. At T2, the line that joins that particular point with the liquidous line gives us the solid percentage. And the liquid percentage is given by the line that joins that point with the solidus curve. That's the reverse, right? And you have to remember this fact. This is called Liebherr's principle. The line that joins the liquidus curve gives us the solid percentage, and the line that joins the solidus core gives us the liquid percentage. So you can clearly see there is more solid in the system than the liquid at temperature T2. Now, applying Liebherr's rule, the weight percentage of solid equal to solid divided by total solid plus liquid whole into 100. Now, if you look in the figure, then the line between 20 and 40 is 30. So the solid composition is 60 minus 30, that equal to 30, and the liquid is 70 minus 60, that equal to 10. Okay. So putting these values in the equation, we will get the weight percentage of solid is 75%. And we can clearly see the weight percentage of solid equal to the distance of A from the liquidus divided by the total distance into 100, and the weight percentage of liquid equal to the distance of A from solidus divided by the total distance into 100. Okay, next question. Consider a schematic isobaric ternary phase diagram ABC shown below. The diagram, which is contoured with isoplates of liquid temperatures in degree Celsius, reveals the crystallization behavior of the melt L of different composition during cooling. When a melt of composition A lies at temperature of 1800 degrees Celsius, the variance or the degree of variance of the magmatic system is. Now, if you look in the figure, then you can see that crystallization start at 1700 degrees Celsius. So, at 1800 degrees Celsius, no melt is converted to crystals. Okay. So, there is only phase, that is liquid phase. So, phase equal to 1. And because it is a ternary system, so component equal to 3. And we have to apply the reduced phase rule here because it is an isobaric condition, and P plus F equal to C plus 1. And if you put the value of P and C, then you can find the degree of freedom equal to 3. Okay. Next question. An eclogite consists of garnet 60% and umphacite 40%, where the mineral abundance are mole percentage, and we are given the mole fraction of magnesium equal to magnesium divided by magnesium plus iron, and that of garnet and umphacite is 0.5 and 0.75 respectively. Then the mole fraction of eclogite is. So we have a rock eclogite in which there is two minerals. One is garnet 60% and the other one is umphacite, that is 40%. Okay. The mole fraction of magnesium in garnet is 0.5. And the mole fraction of magnesium in umphacite is 0.75. So the mole fraction of magnesium in total eclogite is the mole fraction of garnet into its abundance plus the mole fraction of magnesium in umphacite into its abundance. Okay. So 0.5 into 60% plus 0.75 into 40%. And if you calculate, the value comes out to be 0.6. The next and the last question of today's class is, a hasburgite contains pure frosterite and pure enstatite in a molecular ratio of 60:40. Now the mole percentage of MgO in the rock is. So we have the formula of frosterite as Mg2SiO4, and if you break it down, then we'll have 2 moles of MgO and 1 mole of SiO2. Similarly, the formula of enstatite is MgSiO3. And if you break it, you will get 1 mole of MgO and 1 mole of SiO2. So, in frosterite, we have 2 moles of MgO out of total 3 moles. So, the mole percentage of MgO in frosterite is 2 by 3 into 60%, and the mole percentage of enstatite is 1 by 2 into 40%. And if you calculate, the mole percentage of MgO in the rock comes out to be 0.6, that is 60%.